Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
Hey, what's going on, guys? This is Zeke. This is Dogumentary TV. This is a YouTube channel for dog lovers. If you guys haven't already, please go ahead and subscribe to the channel. Today, we have a special guest that really comes to you guys based on your insistence that we talk about Bandogs. And, you know, Bandogs, I guess, if you look at my channel, it's probably something that I should have covered in depth by now. The reality of it is that there just aren't that many people around the world breeding for Bandog type dog, or Bandogs in general. And there definitely are very few reputable people doing the work. But today, I think I got the man, if not the man, one of the men that are that has a serious program that's rooted in science, rooted in experience, experimentation, and just a lot of hard work. So today I bring to you guys Mr. Lee Robinson. How's it going, sir?
Good, great. And you?
I'm wonderful, man.
Like
thanks a lot.
Say that again? I need to wipe my camera there.
Okay. Yeah, thanks again. Thanks for taking the time, man. I know we talked maybe a year or two ago. I was supposed to come out to Mississippi and see you. I don't know what exactly happened. I know you're a busy guy. And then I know COVID happened, so that kind of delayed things for us. But I'm glad to do it this way, and I still would love to come out and see your dogs. I've been watching a ton of your video, your content. And if you got, what's your YouTube channel real quick? I'm sorry. I know it's American Sentinel.
What's my YouTube channel?
Yeah, folks wanted to find your videos to learn more about you real quick.
Yes. Yes, it's American Sentinel Canine. Is my with the K and the number 9.
Right, there you go. So if you guys want to find him, if you want to guys want to get more information from Lee, you can go check out his YouTube channel. I've been doing a lot of research watching a lot of his videos this week trying to get ready for this interview, and just came to realization that this man has a lot of information to share. But we're going to narrow this conversation.
Let me get these dogs to hush real quick. Just a second.
Okay, no, give me 1 second. I want you to go ahead, come let you walk through and you're going to show us a facility, right?
Yeah, I will.
Okay, yep, for sure. So we can start with that. So I know the dogs are going to probably get excited when you come through, but I was going to let them know. So this conversation, for the most part, is going to be limited to the talks of Bandogs, the concept, just around Bandogs. Like I said, Lee has a ton of information, so maybe we'll bring him back, or I hope to bring him back probably a lot of times based on the amount of information that I've seen him speak about well on the internet. But he's promised me to kind of give you guys a tour of the American Sentinel facility. I'll show you some of his dogs. I know a lot of you guys love to see the dogs more than you love to see our pretty faces. So,
Lee, you talking about yourself?
No, I'm talking about us. Me and you, bro. We do. Let's show us around what you got. Let them know. Let them see what you're working with.
All right. Well, the goal of the American Sentinel Canine Program is to be a family companion guardian. That's the number one goal. Then we do some hog hunting with them as well, just because they certainly have the drives for that. But over here, I actually have two game bred pit bulls. This is a Sorrel's dog. And even though she's black, most Sorrel's dogs are not black. Most of them are going to be your buckskin red color, but she's black. She's got a little bit of Boudreaux stuff back in her, and even though she's got a lot more Sorrel's blood in her, the best dog in the litter happened to be black, and I'm not gonna just worry about color. We're worried about performance. She's about 52 pounds, which is a pretty big game dog, and this is my boy Lucky Seven. He's a red boy Jocko, and those of you that know the my phone looks crooked. What's up with that? Huh. That's weird. There we go. Those of you that know, I see what it is. It's backwards on the camera. Those of you that know Patrick's Bolio was a Zeke Goldie cross. And that's what the Sorrel's Foundation is also Zeke Goldie. And then you have the famous dog, Mayday, who was a Patrick Red Boy Jocko dog. And that's what my boy Lucky Seven here is a Red Boy Jocko dog. So, a little hard to see that when they go backwards, but This is actually my quarantine kennel, but we're at max capacity, so we're using the quarantine kennel right now just for boarding. That's why those kennels are only like 8 feet long. Most of my kennels are about 12 feet or wide and 20 feet long, or 6 feet, 8 inches wide and 20 feet long. So here's the old kennel. And we'll start here. It's interesting how this works backwards, doing this, doing it like this. So this is Mystique. She is out of Reptar and Halo. And we got our house dog. I should really start with our house dog. That's my boy Reptar. Because our program, like I said, is about family, companion, guardians. And Reptar stays in the house because one thing that was very important to me was for my children to have a dog that was, you know, like home team best friend. I really appreciated that when I was growing up, and I wanted my children to have that same luxury. Hey, Connor, grab a leash and bring Reptar out for just a sec. Oh yeah, that's right. I put him in the kennel. I forgot. He's typically in the house, but this morning when we walked him, he wanted to go goofy on us and rolled around in the dirt. So I put him in the kennel with Halo, and he played. So you're fixing to see Mystique's mother and father actually in the same kennel together in a bit. I'll point them out when we get there. So back to, and we want to build an indoor, we're going to build a house here and get rid of this mobile home and build an indoor training facility where that mobile home is. This is my young dog. This is Balboa. I have to watch the camera instead of the dog. And Balboa, he shows a lot of good commitment. This is Jazz. Is this feeding okay? It's really bouncy on my phone.
It's okay. You know, I was going to say, maybe what you could do is flip the camera around and just you stand behind the camera and kind of work as a cameraman.
Okay.
Yeah, that might be better.
Well, I don't know if I can flip it. Well, you said you wanted a tour of the facility. Rather than me going through all these, we can do that maybe another day.
Okay.
Because people don't want to just see something they can see anytime. They would rather have us, I'm imagining, see a dog do something or answer some questions.
Right.
So we'll look at the facility over here. Go over here. And you can see it's a pretty big place. This gate. So there's the kennel.
Okay, nice.
And we have a total of 18 runs in there. Each one is 6 feet, 8 inches wide, and 20 feet, 4 inches long. And they would go nuts if I walked through it. If you want me to walk through it, I can, but I'm afraid that if I get too far from the house, my Wi-Fi won't work.
Your Wi-Fi, okay. There was a request to see your house dog. Is it that dog nearby or?
Yeah, that's right. He's got an old collar that's on right now. That's kind of funny looking, big old spike collar that was on the dog's store. It was given to me by not Carl Smith. I think it was given to me by Kevin Kovas. And this is my boy Reptar. Let me grab him and put a leash on him. I got a leash right here. And I'll tie him to a tree.
Okay.
You can see him.
Yeah, these people.
But I need to take him back in anyway.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
No, don't worry about it. Take your time. They love the dogs more than they love us. So if we can show them a dog, you know, I'm sure they'll.
Hold on just a minute. Let me sure set thing. This down.
So guys, he's right now. Give him a second. He's going to get this dog together. I know for a fact that you guys prefer to see the dogs than to see us talking or to see me talking. I didn't want to do it that way. Let's do it this way, do it that way. So, yeah, so he's going to get you a dog, his dog Reptar. Just so you guys have something to see, and then we're going to sit down and we're going to talk a bit about the concepts of Bandogs.
It would have been better if I would have had him out already. My apologies.
It's all good.
Can I
don't worry
the
about
camera
it.
Or no?
Say that again.
I said, can I flip the camera?
Yeah, please do.
Probably not.
I don't know.
This is Reptar.
Oh, he's playing with you.
Here we go.
Oh, he's a beautiful boy. How old is he exactly?
Reptar is about 7 years old.
Okay. He's a good old house dog. He's well worn. 7 years old, boy. I tell you, that's a man. They get dogs get even. I tell people I love puppies, but once a dog is, you know, 5, 6, 7 years old, they're still relatively athletic. But they're so worn in terms of their living with you for that amount of time. They just become even better dogs.
Yeah, he's a great dog. So this collar, I'll tell you about that collar in just a second, because there's actually a really cool story to it. Okay. But instead of being distracted by him, let me dump him in the house.
Okay.
Yeah, we have a little puppy that we're raising right now that's out of Sorrel's blood. And one of my females. And that pup's only 5 weeks old. And we were walking it this morning. Reptar was with us. He decided to roll. And so he got dirty.
Oh, we lost him. I guess he'll come back. I mean, I don't like that camera. Let's go to that camera. Let's go to that camera. I need to get this camera out of here. How do I get this camera out? We're not going to worry about it right now. All right, guys. I'm sure he probably had some Wi-Fi issues, but oh, there you go. It's coming right back. Appreciate that. Boom. All right, we're back.
Sorry about that.
No, it's all good.
I'm still outside, and they got quiet. They get excited and go crazy when I get a dog out.
I'm sure. So, yeah, so if you want to, you know, if you want to sit down somewhere and just sit the camera down, we can start the interview process.
Yeah, I'm good. Actually, I'll stay out here. My kids are in the house, and they'll shut up here in a sec.
Okay, perfect. So before we get started, obviously, you know, I've done a lot of research on you, but I'm sure there's some people watching who don't know who you are quite yet. So if you would just go ahead and introduce yourself as a professional, as a scientist, and as a dog man.
Sure. Well, I've had animals my whole life. It's part of who I am. You heard me talking about it was important to me for my children to have a dog that was tight with them the way I had a dog that was tight with me when I was a kid. And but that happened really. Having a dog for my kid was a thought that happened much later in the game. Hey! Sorry for yelling.
It's okay.
So the reason why I say much later in the game, back when I was, you know, 22 years ago, when I started breeding, that was actually after I had already done nearly a decade of research. And the reason why I did about a decade of research was when I was in my 20s, so we were talking about 30 years ago now, when I was in my 20s, I knew I wanted another dog, and my major when I was in college was actually wildlife and fisheries at first, and I changed to accounting because I was always really good at math and science, and I was like, well, even though I'm good at math, it's not really what I want to do for a living. What do I want to do? I want to work with animals, so I changed my degree again to animal sciences. So unfortunately, because I changed my degree goal, three different degrees, changed it twice. It took me 5 years to get my bachelor's, and then that was in my animal sciences, and that's because I wasted some time switching career goals. But I decided I really want to pursue what it is that is my goal, and my goal was working with animals and actually working with youth. I like working with young people a lot, too, so I actually became an educator for a living. But I got a bachelor's degree and a master's degree in animal sciences, and I was certified in artificial insemination. I worked for the Cincinnati Zoo and Botanical Gardens for a little while, back when I was in college, right, you know, between summer times or between time off and things like that. There was a facility there called CREW, and back then, I could have sworn it was called the Center of Reproduction of Endangered Wildlife, but now they call it like Conservation and Research of Endangered Wildlife or something like that. The times have changed over the 30 years ago, but it's still CREW. And so they were dealing with reproduction, and reproduction and genetics and animal behavior and husbandry have always been personal interests of mine. And I had a really good dog when I was young. It was just a golden retriever, just a pet, but she went everywhere with me and was one of my best friends because we also moved several times. I we lived in Urbana, Illinois, then moved to another place in Urbana. Then we went to New York for a while. Then we came back to Champaign. And all of this was during my childhood. So what did I have that was consistently with me? I had my dog. Yeah, we had friends and stuff like that. But the dog was always there. And so that was just something that meant a lot to me. And then, you know, like I said, time goes on. I got my degrees. And when I was doing my research, I actually worked with ARSA, the Akita Rescue Society of America, for a while. And I adopted a couple of Akitas. They were neutered. I had no desire to breed. I didn't have the place to breed. I just wanted a couple of dogs. And Akitas are, you know, they're actually a lot more malleable than some people might expect. I hear a lot of people talking about them really kind of being dominant and alpha and super territorial. Maybe it was my lifestyle back then. Maybe I was pretty social, but my dogs were actually pretty social. And we did a lot of obedience training, got canine good citizenships titles on them. We did some novelty tricks, like I could send the dog out 100 yards, have it sit down, crawl back to me, sit up at halfway, wave at me from a distance, could be running full speed at me, say down, and they'd hit the ground and slide, just like it was sliding into home base. We just did stuff that was fun, but I had two dogs and I didn't have a family. So the responsibilities of a college student allow a lot of time to do fun things like that. And one of the other things I was doing, and this was before I decided to major in animal sciences, I was actually at the University of Illinois' library, not the big library that has, 20,000. No, it's more than that, I'm sure, square feet. It's huge. It's probably 50,000 square feet. But I went into the Department of Agriculture library, which was a much smaller library, but it was all animal stuff. And I actually came across Carl Semensik's book called The World of Fighting Dogs. And the collar that I actually have on Reptar right now that I showed you just a minute ago was actually on a dog that was in that book. It was a band dog by the name of Thor. It was owned by Kevin Kovas. And Kevin Kovas gave me that collar and also gave me an old treadmill that you saw Thor that was running in that book. And he gave me those two items and got a dog for me. So that was pretty cool. This was, I don't know, 15 years ago, it's been more than that, probably 18 years ago. But I just got to know the band dog, and I kept studying the band dogs because, honestly, the pit bulls, in my opinion, they were one of my favorite breeds, but they were too small for my goals for a family guardian. And I like a dog that's going to be able to not only win a combative situation, but win that combative situation quickly. When you're dealing with a family companion guardian type of dog, if a perpetrator, an intruder, an attacker comes into the house, it's not always about can the dog win. It's about can the dog win and win quickly, because we need the dog to control the threat so we have time to get to safety if it's just my children, if I'm not here, or if I am here to go grab backup if I need to get a firearm or something and I don't happen to have one on me. Sometimes I carry one, but sometimes I don't. You know, obviously, if you're just chilling, you don't always have it on you. And so that dog, if you're asleep or something like that, you need time to wake up. And so that dog needed to have enough size to do those type of capabilities. And I wanted a dog with a lot of natural instinct. I do train my own dogs to engage on command. But honestly, I'm not really interested in sports, and I don't want to talk bad about any sports. I think they're great for what they are, but they're just not my cup of tea, because if you train a dog to engage, you have to be extremely, extremely responsible. And even though I'm personally very responsible, and sometime when we do a yard tour, maybe I'll get a video done where it's not going to be so quiet or so loud, and I can send it to you and you can post it if you want to. But our facility, every kennel has two latches, and on the end of the aisle there's an aisle gate that has two latches, and we normally keep those locked. I just walked away a minute ago and left it open, but that's atypical. But anyway, you have to have maximum security, and I don't really believe in sending dogs off leash. You know, you need to be able to do that for a situation that calls for it, but legally speaking, that's going to be a very far and few between situation. If you ever send your dog, you're going to have a a court battle. So I don't want to be in that situation. So even though a dog should be able to do that, let's say a person grabs my little baby girl and takes off running, then I may have to send the dog to slow that person down. But even then, there's a potential of danger because I don't want him to fall over and land on my daughter, you know, right? So, but it's better to catch him than to let him get away. But generally speaking, a protection dog should be worked on a leash or in your home or in a gate, behind a gate that's so secure there's no way the dog can get out. I believe in securing my family, my property, but I also don't want to do that at the expense of endangering an innocent party. The only people that should ever get bit are guilty people that are up to malice, you know. I'm not interested in protecting the criminal, but I'm also not interested in harming anybody that's innocent. This is a huge responsibility. But anyway, back to why I chose the band dog. So the dog had to be bigger than the pit bull, but I still wanted the great type of athleticism that the pit bull has. And if you look at the mastiffs are less prone to run down and engage somebody from a distance because they do have that loyalty with the family. But they're just so sloppy and they drool. And I don't care whose mastiff you deal with, you know, basically any of those giant dogs can't take the heat tolerance that I expect from my dogs. Back when I had my Akitas, there was two things I didn't like about my Akitas. They shed like crazy. Every day you have to sweep up the house. I wanted a clean dog. And the other thing is when I would go for a mountain bike ride or a long hike, those Akitas couldn't take that heat. And I wanted a dog that had good heat tolerance. So obviously the pit bull helped rectify that situation. And I wasn't going to just use any line of pit bulls. I don't believe dogs should be called a pit bull unless it's a true game-bred dog that comes from those type of situations. So we used game-bred dogs, and we also used the English Mastiff, and we also used the Tosa Inu, and there's a little bit of Neapolitan Mastiff in our program as well. Well, not so much of a little bit anymore. You know, it's basically most of our dogs are around 62.5% game-bred pit bull. There's a few that are 75% and a few that are 50%. But most of them are going to be within those percentages. And then the remaining 50% and less is, generally speaking, going to be mostly English Mastiff, some Neapolitan, and then a small amount of Tosa Inu that's way back in the back. You know, even though I personally, years ago, we had dogs that were 50% Tosa, but only one Tosa, and that was 20 years ago. So it's been a long time since I bought that dog. And so, of course, it's been watered down.
Lee, let me step in for a second real quick. I'm sorry, because you kind of, that was actually one of my questions. And what I wanted to ask you was, so when you say Neapolitan, Tosa, a lot of American Pit Bull Terrier, game dog, game-bred American Pit Bull Terriers, just explain to me what each of those breeds, an English Mastiff, so, I'm sorry. Yeah. Explain to me what each of those dogs bring to your formula for your band dog.
All right. Well, there's a major misconception in the band dog community and even the dog community as a whole that worries too much about breed. The breed is far less important than is finding the right dog. Right. The English Mastiff, generally speaking, is a large, they call it gentle giant. But if you go back to the breed's history, at one time they were a very good, formidable guard dog. And they became a gentle. It's so interesting how my phone tilts the way it does. I don't know why it does that. It seems totally backwards. But the English Mastiff is going to be the biggest. It's going to have the most power. But because they tend to be a gentle giant, one of the problems with the English Mastiff is they tend to have a lot of nerve issues. They tend to get nervous and overly corrected. They're very submissive to their family, but that makes them safe with their family, see? So while they may be formidable against a stranger, and some of them aren't because some of them have gotten too nervous, some of them have gotten too insecure. But when you find a confident one, they're the biggest and strongest of the Mastiffs. Another thing is the English Mastiff tends to have way better hips when you find a good one than does like a Neapolitan. Neapolitans are pretty much a structural nightmare. The Neapolitan does have a good guarding instinct. Some of the Neapolitans tend to be nervous and insecure, which I don't like. But they do have defense, and they do have tight bonding with their family. And so that tight bonding with their master, that's a good trait to be with their family. But some of them are so tight that if you leave them, they become insecure on their own. So this is a fault that has to be fixed in that breed if you're interested in mastiffs. Me personally, I don't want to offend any mastiff people, but they're just not for me. I'm not a mastiff fan. I don't like sloppy dogs. I don't like dogs that can't run a long time or work a long time. It is a nice day today, but here in Mississippi, a nice day is in the low 80s, and it'll probably be 85 by the time the day's over. And we're not even into the hot weather yet. It's been a pretty mild year. It's going to be 9,500 degrees here. I've only had one mastiff in my life that could work all day in the middle of July. And ironically, it's crazy, but it was my English mastiff. And she was 150 pounds. And that dog could run all day. I've never seen another English mastiff that could do that. And so that's what I mean by you have to look at the dog rather than the breed, because there are anomalies that exist. And anomalies are the keystone to a successful band dog program. Because if you breed to, you know, it's really nice if you can find a line that is consistent for the traits that you're looking for. But in the mastiff community, you're just not going to find it. Not that I know of. I don't know anybody that's breeding working mastiffs and producing working mastiffs when it comes to the English, the Neapolitan, or the Tosa on a consistent basis. Although the Tosa is probably going to be the most consistent because of their activities over in Japan and Korea. But we had a true anomaly of an English mastiff. Eclipse is why my program is successful today. She was a gem. She was worth a gold mine. She could, like I said, she could work all day in the middle of July and August when it's 95 degrees out. And she was super bold. She never started a conflict, but if a conflict ever came her way, she would never yield. And she was the mother of my boy Preacher Man, and also a mother to his siblings, of course, which would be Bandit and Gator and Thin Ice. But the sire, what we bred Eclipse to, was a Sorrel's bred game dog. Now, when I say build your program off of anomalies, I'm talking about the mastiff side. If you can find consistent programs that are producing consistent dogs, that's great, but you need those great, great, great exceptions. So let's say you have this bell-shaped curve, which is a curve that goes like this, you know, like this. Well, I'm trying to do it with the camera.
Yeah, I think we know what the bell curve is.
Well, some people don't, but if you have that okay. Bell-shaped curve,
yep.
You want to find those extreme individuals. So even if you're dealing with a program that has good consistency, you need to find those extreme individuals, because this is your foundation. This is what you're building off of. And so you want to take those dogs to the next level. And to take those dogs to the next level, you have to really put in the time and work to find those extremely exceptional individuals. And so that's what I was looking for when it came to the mastiff. And then when it came to the game blood, I looked in the different programs that were out there, and Bert Sorrels' program, what was one of the first programs that had game dogs that were actually doing Schützen work. He actually had dogs that were over in Germany at the time. He had some dogs over in like Russia, and or not necessarily Russia, but some of those other countries that are over in that area, Czechoslovakia and whatnot. They were doing protection work, and then his dogs have held outstanding records in the game dog industry. They're also larger than most. And because I knew they were capable of doing protection work and they had more size than most game dogs, even though on average his dogs are probably only a few pounds bigger than the pit bull average, but he's known for occasionally producing some bigger dogs. And so that's why we looked at his program, and we actually got a couple of bigger dogs. We got one bigger dog from him, and we also bred to one of his dogs that was really big, a dog named Champion Pokey, Sorrel's Champion Pokey. But Captain Skip was the father to Preacher Man, and Preacher Man became the foundation of our program, him and his siblings. And that was, like I said, the English Mastiff. The Neapolitan, like we kind of described that as well. The Tosa Inu if I was going to start it all over, that would be a breed that I would really look into. The Tosin and the Borbal have really kind of come a long way here in the United States. 20 years ago, 30 years ago, you didn't really see them. I knew a few people that had some Tosas, and I worked with some of them. But the Tosa is structurally a much sounder dog, at least it was back then. On average, my dog Eclipse was just as sound as any Tosa that could ever exist, but we have to look at on average of the breed. So, you know, like I said, the individual is far more important than the breed generality, because I'm not going to be using a lot of Neapolitan. I'm not going to be using a lot of Tosa Inu. I'm not going to be using a lot of English Mastiff. So we find those exceptional individuals. Plus, those breeds, generally speaking, aren't really line bred to begin with. And since they're not super line, you know, there are some that are. Especially probably in the English, but because they're generally speaking not line bred, they're not going to be the most consistent producers. And this, as a result, even if you get great dogs in the first generation, the tough thing about a band dog program is to survive over time, because a lot of times the worst generations you're going to have in a band dog program, even though you may get some great individuals in every generation, a lot of times that second and that third generation really tough with first generation consistency coming from a lot
of the time. Lee, we're having issues. Give me one second.
Line bred pit bull into
you're freezing up for me on me a little bit, Lee. I'm losing your audio. Hold on.
Yeah, I see that. I see that. My wife and my two children and two dogs are in the house, so that's why I didn't go inside. I tried to stay next to the room that's got the Wi-Fi connection, even though I'm outside.
All right. Go ahead and start back up for me and see if it kind of resolved itself.
Do you want me to exit and then come back in, like you did on the one of your other interviews? I watched one of your other interviews.
Yeah, you know what? Right, we can go ahead and do that for sure. We can do that for sure. Let's try that.
All right.
Thanks. All right, I got to get rid of that camera. All right, guys. So we're in the middle of an interview, and obviously technology is not. Technology is great. Let's be honest, but I think Lee is in Mississippi. I know some people like use data. I mean, you know, where Lee lives, it may not be a strong data connection, and Wi-Fi might be the best option. So we're gonna put up with it, because I believe that what Lee is giving us is canine gold, so we're gonna just kind of be patient. I know I have no problems with being patient. You back, Lee?
Yeah, well, I think I am, but I got all these windows open on my phone. I don't know why. I'll turn it back in just a second.
You seem to be in a better space.
All right, let's see if this works better. I had like 12 windows on my phone, so that may have been part of my Wi-Fi issue right there.
Okay.
So now I just got you.
All right, cool. Let me ask you. So you kind of broke down the dogs that you use, and I understand. Yeah, we don't focus on breed so much as we focus on specific specimens within the breed. But more so than anything, I'm gonna go back to this. I'm gonna start at the beginning of my questions. And what I want to know is, because there's a lot of I'm gonna say controversy, but a lot of, I guess conversation. One second. I think I just lost you again. I did. Let me just see if I can get rid of this camera. How do I get rid of this camera? I just lost Lee again. I'm sure he'll call back in. Let me be patient and wait for that. Harmon Summer, I said I got a super chat from you. Let's see how we do this. Let's go ahead and add you to the conversation. Thank you, sir. Or I don't know if Harmon is I'm assuming Harmon. That's a very ambiguous name. But thank you so much for the super chat. I definitely appreciate that. I'll be using that to make better videos, get out there, and make the channel stronger. All right, Lee. Sorry about that. Are you
no cool? problem. I had a phone call come in, and they kicked me off.
Ah, is that what it was? Okay.
Yeah. Is there a way to stop that from happening when I'm on a video with you?
That's a great question. I don't know.
All right. No worries. If it happens again, my apologies to your viewers.
No, that's all
good. Go ahead.
All right. So I was going to ask you... So tell me, basically, what is a band dog? I mean, historically speaking, what is a band dog?
Yeah, this is another major misconception about the Bandog. You know, a lot of people think it's just a pit bull mastiff cross, and while that is basically what I've done, that's not what the word actually means. The, you know what, everybody here knows what a rubber band is. Remember the word band and rubber band. Rubber is what it's made out of, but band is what it does. A bandage, a band-aid, to any type of band, B-A-N-D, means to hold back or hold together. And a band dog is a dog that is held back or held, you know, with together with the handler or together with a post or together with some sort of restraint. It's held back and banded because when it's released, it's going to catch its quarry. And quarry is like its prey item, its target, its opponent, its whatever it is, you know, whether it be a criminal or whether it be a dangerous animal. Any dog that has to be held back to prevent engagement is historically, you know, basically a band dog. Right. Now, were they mostly mastiff type dogs or bulldog type dogs? I'm sure they were. Okay. There's no disagreement on that. But as far as what the word means, that's what it means. A sled dog pulls a sled. A hound dog is hunts. A band dog is a dog that's held back and it's released to catch its quarry. That's what the word means.
All right, very cool. So let me ask you this. Obviously, you're familiar with Swinford and his program.
Yeah, very much. I've got, I don't know if you've seen the video, or I don't know if you've seen my page on John Swinford, but we've got letters from his family members, from his close associates, one of his vet partners. They sent me, I don't know, a lot of pictures and documents and articles and things like that. I've got his breed standard that was written on his kitchen table. I've got all that in my house.
Oh, cool. And so do you consider yourself to be a part of his legacy, or are you just, you're doing something different?
No, he was neither. I'm not doing something different, and I'm also not part of his legacy.
Okay.
He's a person that did some work that influenced me and helped direct me to my goals. But I never met the man, and I never owned any of his dogs. We were interested in, for a little while, a long time ago, we even kind of called our dogs Swinfords to give him credit for, because I don't like programs that name their dogs after themselves. You know, there's some people that have, like, the Doberman Pinscher is one of the few that has been successful. Generally speaking, when a person names a dog after themselves, it's going to be hard for that breed to exist over time, because if anybody wants a Doberman, who are you going to get it from? You're going to get it from Louis Doberman, except he couldn't. That was actually not even the name that Doberman gave his dog. It was his protege that did that. But so that was a sign of appreciation to the man that created that combination. So I didn't want to name the dogs after me, because I want these dogs to live after me. Right. When I'm dead, I want other people to pick up the gauntlet and carry it on. And I think that it's kind of egotistical to name them after me. I'm going to need other people to work with for this to be a long-term project that continues to proliferate after I'm extinguished. So as a result of that, you know, we call them American Sentinels. But back to your question on Swinford, he influenced me. As far as my mentors, I've had many, many mentors. Some of them I've met and got to know. Some of them I didn't ever get to meet. I just researched it. The person that's going to be the most influenced, yes, is going to be the person that you see in the mirror, because you have to be willing to do the work. But there's hundreds of people that are behind any success that I have, because they made my work easier, because I didn't have to go learn everything from scratch. I was able to build off of their knowledge. So major props to all the founders of and fathers of the working dogs that came long before I did. Without them, we wouldn't be here.
And so, okay, so let me jump back into my questions, because I definitely addressed some of my issues. So let me just figure out where I'm at, because there's some things that I want to do, but I just want to kind of keep what I would consider the continuity of this thing together. Let's talk about you have this concept of the game bred band dog.
Yes. Or, yeah. I think it's important to use game bred dogs in your program. I'm not going to line breed on the Mastiffs. I'm not going to line breed on the Neapolitans. I'm not going to line breed on the Tosa Inu. Even the Tosa Inu, in my opinion, is not a game dog. It's more of a whoop.
Uh-oh.
Sorry about that. Did That's I lose okay. you? Oh, crap. Let's see. Oh.
We lost audio. I think, did you hit a button? Oh, you know what? You muted yourself. You're still muted. Okay. Oh, we lost. I gotta get rid of that. I gotta get rid of that camera. That's the FaceTime camera on my computer. So ugly image. You know, I work hard to get this lighting right and use this high-end camera so that I look professional. All right, here we go. Let's get Lee back in here. We got audio?
Can you hear
yes,
me now?
I hear you now. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
All right. I didn't know how to fix it, so I just left.
Okay.
man, I'm botching
listen,
your
listen,
stuff.
Listen. I woke up this morning and my kids are like, yo, the internet's working, Dad. And I look, I'm going through everything. What did I do? I unplugged it and plugged it back in. That's what
yeah.
you do.
And next time, if we do something like this, maybe we can do it inside where if my kids are gone. But with the kids, I don't want to like tell them to be quiet for an hour, you know?
Right, I understand.
So where were we? What were you asking? Oh, why the game bred Bandog?
Yeah.
So, to me, the Tosa Inu is not really a game dog. They're a formidable rank-driven dog that will engage with some decent skills, but they don't have that deep bottom for when they receive a lot of stress. If you've ever seen those dogs perform, they will go out of hold and then kind of stand around and catch their breath, and then they'll do a lot of posturing and see if it's over. And the rules are different than the Cajun rules for the game dog world. And the game dog world, let's look at it from, even though I'm personally not involved in game dog activities, when I say that, you know what I'm talking about. I'm not involved in that. I'm interested in protection work, and I'm interested in hog catch work. So when you're doing protection work, you can't really do a true game test, okay? That would be abuse, animal abuse, and you could get yourself in trouble. However, when you're hog hunting, there are certainly times that, while generally speaking, hog hunting 99 times out of 100 is not going to be a game test. There are some, maybe I shouldn't say 99 out of 100, maybe 19 out of 20 times it's not a game test. Every once in a while, though, here in Mississippi, when you've had a dog that's run for 5 miles and you have a dog that's hot and it's 90 degrees out, and you catch and encounter a big boar that totally dominates and injures your dog, it requires a decent amount of determination to remain engaged. And so I notice what happens in situations like that. And I also notice my dog's response when they have just general life. And so, but what do I focus on my pedigrees? My pedigrees, I'm always incorporating game dogs that go back to true game dogs. I mean, I'm incorporating more game dogs that come from working camps. And so I'm trying to capture that dog that never says die. You know, I'm going to impose my will. And if there's any regrets, I'll deal with those regrets tomorrow. Because right now I have to stop this threat. Right now I have to engage this hog. And they want to do it. I want a dog that wants to work. I don't believe in making dogs work. The game bred dog is just a dog that shouldn't quit.
Right, right. So, okay, so basically we identified that your dogs do two of their jobs, protection work, catch work. Is there anything else that your dogs are good at?
Being a family companion.
Family companion?
Yeah, I mean, I don't want a dog that's rank driven. I don't want dominant natured dogs. I want my dogs to be stable and trustworthy with a family. Could you do other things with them besides protection work and hog catch? Yeah, if a person wanted to do agility, they could do that. If they wanted to do sport work, they could do that.
How about weight pull?
Why not? As long as the dog's got good drives and has a desire to please and is structurally sound and is efficient pound for pound, is athletic, and powerful. Yeah, of course.
So I'm sure you don't necessarily have a written standard for your dogs, but is
I
there,
do.
Oh, you do. Okay, perfect. Could you tell me your written standard?
Well, the main thing is that they're going to be athletic in performance. It's all centered around that. If you look at the pit bull standard, when you say tell you about your standard, my standard's a couple of pages long. But if I tell you about, you know, like the pit bull standard, it's kind of like that. And the reason why I compare it to the pit bull standard is anybody that wants to see the details of the pit bull standard can actually go look it up and see that it's focused continually on performance. They're not the old pit bull standard, like the ADBA standard from, I don't know if they've updated it. So let's go back to like 1980 or 1970 or 1960, a standard that was a long time ago when they were working these dogs. And you'll see it's all centered around performance. There's not much size description. Yes, the pit bull, there's a little bit of size description, but they make allowances for dogs outside of that description if they perform. And so that's something that you can continually see in my written standard, is that when a dog is outside of the standard, that's okay as long as that dog still performs. But there are a few things that I can mention to you. Basically, I like my females to be around 24 to 26, maybe even as much as 27 inches at the wither. So 24 to 27 inches, that's a pretty wide range for a female. And my males will be anywhere from 25 to 28 inches, basically. I like my male dogs to be basically 85 to 105 pounds. I will allow them to get up to 125 or even 130 pounds if they still perform. But I'm going to tell you, those bigger dogs, just they can't deliver the type of performance that I want. I have found the dogs, the ideal perfect dog, in my opinion, is going to be around 100 pounds, 90, maybe 90 to 100 pounds is like the ideal perfect size dog. And it's interesting because when you first start a lot of band dog programs, a lot of people have a lot of interest in these really big dogs that are like 120, 130 pounds. But when you've experienced them for decade after decade, and you've worked hundreds and hundreds, if not thousands, of these dogs, you continually find, why are the best ones always around 90 to 95 pounds? They're not only more athletic, a lot of times they're more capable, because think about, you know, it's not always just blunt brute force like people think. You need enough brute force, but you also need enough agility to get in the proper position. If a person is arm wrestling per se, but they're not in the right position, a weaker person with a superior position can win. Wrestling a person, it's, you know, you have to be agile enough to get in position. If you're tired, too tired to get in position, your strength is useless. If you're out of breath because, you know, you don't have any oxygen running through your bloodstream because you've used up all your oxygen and you're depleted and you can't breathe, this is what you see in the toes of the inus in competition, then it doesn't matter how powerful you are. You have to have enough power, but also enough agility and stamina to be able to perform. And those dogs that, in my opinion, are like the best balance, that perfect male dog is about 90 to 95 pounds. 100, when you get over 100 pounds, they start to lack. There are a few exceptions to that, but we're starting to get into the anomalies of the anomalies. And the reason why I say that is my whole yard is getting to a point where even my average dog or even my lower performing dogs are still superior dogs compared to most programs. And I don't like saying that because it sounds egotistical, but if you want me to just tell your viewers what I really think,
I do.
And so that's what I really think. And, but if you take my best ones, the best dogs I've got here, some people have never seen a dog like that in their life. They can't even imagine a dog doing what some of these dogs are capable of doing. Another thing that I like about a little bit smaller dog, and this, you know, my standard allows males as low as 80 pounds is something okay with me, which is pretty small for a band dog program, in my opinion. But an 80-pound dog that does his job exceptionally well and outperforms a 100-pound dog, I'd rather take the 80-pound any day. There's a couple advantages of that 80-pound dog or 90-pound dog. It's going to be easier and perform better in your car if you're ever having to do a car scenario. And where do people get attacked? A lot of times it's in a parking lot or an ATM machine, and it might be in the car or a drive-through gas station fast food place, something like that. That's where attacks happen, is gas stations, ATMs, and parking lots, you know. So a dog that could perform better in a car is going to have an advantage. Another advantage of a little bit smaller dog is, And this is kind of silly, but one of the reasons why I don't like dogs that are 120 pounds is I can't really expect a 120 pound dog to, if it's in a kennel, to for a 55 gallon barrel to be sufficient doghouse. And the reason why I say that is a 55 gallon barrel is about is fine up to about 105, 110 pounds. These igloos that are made out that are allow you to have a bigger dog or a wooden dog house, such as this right here, which allows a bigger dog. The problem with these is dogs will chew on them and they will break and crack and chip. And even the plastic igloos, they will crack. And so I don't want my dogs to get injured from that. The cool thing about the 55 gallon drums is they're like rubbery. They're even though they're plastic, they don't chip off. And this is something that's you got to have a you know, to house the dog properly. And I don't want to. We lost Wrecker. Wrecker was 130 pounds. Why did we lose him? He chewed on an igloo and it messed up his gut. And so that was an unfortunate loss. He was about 8 years old and it was an unfortunate loss. But that's what took him out. And so that's just reminds me some of the advantage of the smaller dogs. They're just every. And my point here is they're easier for everyday
right,
life.
Right, right, right. So you, real quickly, you kind of touched on a pet peeve of mine because one of the things that I see a lot is people talking about 200-pound dogs, 200-pound Borbles. We had a 200-pound this, 200-pound that, and you know, and I'm not the experience you have, but just in my limited amount of experience, I just always find dogs. I mean, any breed, I don't care, even a English Mastiff. Once they get above like 140 pounds, I see diminishing returns there. On the size.
There's two problems there. Problem number one is the big dog is almost always overweight. Okay.
Right.
So if your dog is like right now, I weigh 225 pounds. Guess what? I'm not a 225 pound man. If I was going to be in a performance venue, I should be like 175 pounds. I'm like 225 pound man. Yeah. With 50 pounds of fat. Right. So now you're saying, okay, are you really 175 pounds or really a 275 pounds? Because if I say a 225 pound man with 50 pounds of fat, is that with my fat removed or with my fat on? Because that's 100 pound variation there. All right. So yeah, I'm 225 with my body fat. So I'm really 175 pound man if I'm in shape. And this is, I see the same thing with the dog world. It's like people feed their dog and right after they feed it, they don't let it go pee or poop. And then they put it on the scale. It's like, let's stuff the dog as max as possible, throw it on the scale. And the male dog that you're looking at, you're thinking, is that a male or a female? Cause he looks like he's about to have a litter.
Right.
Pups. He's so fat. He can't breathe. Can't work. That's not a 200 pound animal. When I got Eclipse, she was actually advertised as like 190 pounds. And then I called him. And she was 107 or 180. I start driving out there and she's 170. This is on the phone now. The website says 190. I call him, she's 180. I get in the car to drive out there, she's 170. I get home and weigh her, she's 165, but she was overweight 15 pounds. What do I call her? I don't call her a 190 pound dog. That was baloney. She was a 150 pound dog when she was in shape. And that's what I call her, a 150 pound dog.
Right.
The other problem with that is I remember this. It was so funny. This was like 15 years ago. I was at a small mom and pop shop hardware store, and I was getting some tools, and the guy was asking me what I was making. I told him I was just making a doghouse, and he started telling me about his 100-pound pit bull. And I was like, okay. I didn't really believe him, but because – pit bulls, real pit bulls don't get that big. He got the dog out and he walked around the front. And I was thinking, this dog's like 60 pounds. What are you talking about, 100 pounds? This is like a 60-pound dog. I didn't tell him that. I was just thinking to myself, I'm not going to go out and tell somebody the truth. But if I would have taken a 100, like my back then, a dog named, if you Google Bandog, you'll see a dog that's pictured at night. Where it's a black brindle dog wearing a leather collar that's crisscrossed. I made that collar. That was my dog. His name's Levi. Levi was 108 pounds. Anyway, very anywhere from 104 to 108 pounds. If I'd have taken that dog in there, he'd have been like, "What? This is what a 100-pound dog looks like." And I remember one time when I conditioned him, I actually got him down to like 98 pounds, but he was really too lean there. But he had been running and working a lot during the hunting season. We took him out to the hunting camp, and he actually hunted with me, even though it was deer hunting. He didn't run the dogs. He just stayed with me. Right. But we'd be riding on the four-wheelers, and when we were riding on the four-wheelers, we got him conditioned super lean. He was 98 pounds. And he was almost twice the size of that 100-pound pit bull. but anyway, I diverged. My apologies. So, yeah, I just like a smaller animal that's more capable. And when I say small, it's still majorly big enough. It's still twice the size of a pit bull. You know, 80 to 105-pound American Sentinel is twice the size of a pit bull. Most pit bulls are going to be in the 40 to 50-pound range.
Right. So that gets me to my next question, which is your selection process, because obviously you're selecting these dogs to work. And you have a program, right? So I'm sure, explain how, obviously you said performance is a part of your breed standard. Performance is very important. How does that go into your breeding selection, and then you're selecting dogs in terms of the work that you're going to have them do once they've kind of matured and stuff?
Sure. Well, you reminded me real quick when you said breed standard. One other thing I don't like in a dog is I don't like a lot of white. Since I breed dogs for protection work, I don't want a white dog because white is a target that you can see. It's a weakness in nature. You don't see white deer. You don't see white animals unless you live in the Arctic region. And even in the Arctic region, when it's summertime, they have a gray coat usually. So, you know, white is easy to shoot. It's easy to see at night. You can see the white before you see everything else. So I don't like white on my dogs. So that was one reason why you don't see. People ask me, why don't I use the Dogo? Well, I'm not interested. I have to like work against that. Plus, I don't really think the Dogo is going to meet my standards when it comes to determination. They've been softened a little bit. That's one of the things that happens with a lot of pure breeds. When they become popular, they become softened. They're not as hardy as I personally like. And also the American Bulldog lacks the endurance that I like. American Bulldogs are very powerful. When it comes to weight pull, one of the best dogs you can use is probably an American Bulldog. Super powerful. But to me, the ultimate man is not the power lifter. The ultimate man is more like the Navy SEAL. That's to me, in my opinion. So I want my dogs to be more like the Navy SEAL type of canine, super athletic, well-rounded athlete, all-around capable dog. Can they lift as much as maybe an American Bulldog? I'm making an analogy here, but can they pull as much as like an American Bulldog in weight pull? I don't know, pound for pound, they actually may be able to. So you'd probably still be fine in weight pull competition. But a big American Bulldog is probably going to out pull one of my, if you're in an open weight, no weight limit, because the Bulldogs get pretty big. You know, they're pretty big, muscular dogs, and they might be a 150-pound dog that's stacked. Like even some of those Borbles are super stacked, all kinds of power. But that's not what I'm looking for. What I'm looking for is I want a lot of prey drive. I don't want a dog that starts trouble, but when trouble comes his way, he's more than happy to engage it. I want a dog that's got good pack instinct, that wants to be with me, wants to be with my family. And I'm talking about a human pack. There's an intraspecies and interspecies. Intraspecies is within the species, like an intrastate. In Hawaii, they don't have interstates. They have intrastates. Because the highways don't travel from state to state because of the ocean. Well, the dogs have this pack instinct with dogs. But because they've been domesticated for tens of thousands of years, they now have this pack instinct also with their human counterparts, this symbiotic relationship. And so this is an interspecies pack instinct where they're crossing the species barrier. I want my dogs that really want to be with me and my family. That's important. And then I also want good nerves. You know, I don't want a dog that gets environmentally concerned easily. I want a dog that's able to work through those type of things. Another thing that I want is extremely good health. If the dog doesn't have good hips or doesn't have a good thyroid or circulatory system or cardiovascular system, it's going to get sore when you work it, and it's not going to have a good recovery time. This dog needs to be able to recover and go back to work the next day. Our lifestyles don't allow us to work it or go do what we want us to. Our lifestyles don't allow us to do what we want to do every time we want to do it. We may have previous obligations. And then we get this vacation time and we want to hunt every day of the week because we're on vacation for a week. that dog may be able to have to go hunting day after day after day for a week. And if that dog can't recover because it's not healthy, then you have a concern that you need to address in your breeding program. You know, people have asked me, what concerns do I have in my dogs? What health problems? And I'm blessed. I have not had any health problems with my dogs. Does that mean I've never had a dog that didn't have a health problem? No, that'd be nonsense. Of course, we've had a dog with hip dysplasia, or we've had a dog with mange, like in the 20 years that I've been breeding. But we've had like 2 dogs out of 1,000 with mange, and we've had like 5 dogs out of 1,000 with hip problems. So you're talking about not even 1%. It's like one for the hip problems. We're talking about a half of 1%. Actually, I've produced over 1,000 dogs. So that's less than, that's so low that I know there's got to be more than that I just didn't find out about. So to me, a breeding problem is when you see a problem reoccurring, when you see a problem that's happening like 4% of the time, or, you know, if you had 4% of the time, that means that problem is in there, but it's not showing up a lot because you have dogs that are heterozygous. But 4% to me is when you're starting to be concerned about genetic problems. If you have a problem that's less than 1%, you're so far above and beyond what's the normal population that you're making major successful steps. You're avoiding those issues big time.
Right, right. Let me ask you this. So in terms of you have your working dog.
How do I select? I go work them.
How do you determine whether the dog's going to be a good catch dog versus a dog that's going to be a good protection dog? What are you looking at?
They're almost the same thing. They're almost the same thing. A catch dog can be playful with people. That's the only thing, that they can be a little sleazy. By sleazy, I mean, you know, they can like everybody. They're not necessarily the most loyal dogs. A lot of people think that like the pit bull is super loyal. Not necessarily. The pit bull is a little bit sleazy. They pretty much love everybody.
Right.
A really loyal animal is kind of like, you know, and I'm not trying to be sexist, but I'm a man. So to me, a good pit bull is kind of like a good woman. It's a person that I can marry that is going to be loyal to me.
Right.
It's friendly to people, but not too friendly.
Right.
And so, you know, that's like more of a protection type dog. It can be tolerant to strangers, but it doesn't have to be super friendly with those strangers. Sorry, I covered my mic, I think. I don't want my dogs to be sleazy with strangers. I don't want them to be friendly with strangers. They should not help the criminal carry the TV out of my house and then jump in their truck because they just want to lick his face.
Right.
That's something that you'll see with some pit bulls. We'll see like these rescue groups. Sometimes they'll go in and raid these places and pick up these pit bulls and talk about how mean and dangerous they are. But when they're carrying them out to put them in the rescue van, the dog's licking the person in the face. And you're like, that's obviously not a mean, dangerous animal. That's just an irresponsible owner. And if they would approach it and blame the owner instead of the breed, that would, in my opinion, would be a step in the right direction. As far as the hog dog can be a little sleazy, but because we're breeding a breeding program for protection work, I don't really breed those dogs that are too sleazy. I want them to have that good pack instinct.
Right, right. So, a lot, in terms of personal protection, home protection, right now within that industry of protection dogs, there seems to be a lot of herding breeds that are kind of popular. Your dogs contrast, and how do they fit into your vision and what makes them better protection animals?
Well, I'm not going to say they're better protection animals, but I will say they're better family companion guardians.
Right.
When it comes to, if you want a junkyard dog, our dogs are awesome. A good German Shepherd is also awesome. A good Rottweiler is also awesome. But when it comes to a family guardian dog, I would not trust a German Shepherd or a Rottweiler with my children in my absence like I would trust one of my dogs. However, one of my dogs could still hurt one of my kids because they're talking about a 100-pound dog that may want to play and step on their back when they're jumping around happy, you know, and wiggly. But my dogs are not mean to my kids. If my kid drops a steak on the ground and the dog goes for that steak, my kid can say, ah, get back, and the dog will, like, yield to my children because they have a better pack instinct. I would not say that that's as that I'm not going to say that won't happen with a German Shepherd or a Rottweiler, but I'm going to say it's less likely to happen. The German Shepherd and the Rottweiler are more of a rank-driven type of dog. And because they're a rank-driven dog, they're in some ways easier to train than a pit bull type of dog or a mastiff type of dog, because pit bulls and mastiffs need to be worked in prey drive and defense, while a herder or a Rottweiler, while those dogs, they say that are a lot of times worked in prey and defense, they're also worked in rank. There's a lot of posturing and dominance that goes into the work. And when trainers don't have a really good understanding of how to properly work defense, what do? These trainers, a lot of times, are using rank drive and posturing to stimulate a defensive response. But then how does that dog engage it? They get that dog that easy win, and the dog is actually just learning to dominate. And so this is more of a dominant type of rank drive work than it is really defensive work. I don't really see a lot of suspicion work being done. Suspicion is incorporated with defense. Posturing is done with rank. So there is a difference in your decoy or your agitator, so to speak. In defense, you have an agitator. And posturing, you have a helper or a decoy. It's a little bit different, posturing versus suspicion work. And for the family companion guardian, I don't want a dog that's interested in working out of dominance. I want him working out of defense and prey.
Right. All right, well, I'm going to stop my part of the interview there because I wanted to give folks an opportunity to call in and ask some questions. I think we covered a lot. I know there's hours.
Yeah, I kind of rambled. My apologies.
No, that's okay. I'm sure there's hours more that we could get into, but I want to offer to you. Oh, let me bring myself back into the image real quick. Sorry, let me do this. Let's do this and do that. Okay, perfect. So you guys, if you guys are watching this right now, you've been watching Mr. Robinson speak for some time now. He's giving you guys a lot of information. I'm sure there's people out there that have questions. If we can get, we have been running a little over an hour right now, so we can get maybe two or three questions in if you guys want to call in. There's a link in the description. Click that link. You can call in right now. I'll bring you into the conversation. You can ask Mr. Robinson anything you want to ask him pertaining to band dogs and specifically the American Sentinel canine. I saw some other questions in the comment section that were not relevant to this program, so we don't want to ask those questions today. Is there anything that you would like to share with us that we haven't covered?
Well, I think it's very important that people listen to themselves. And when somebody comes in with a question, we'll entertain that. But until then, Okay. Listen to yourselves, man. Pursue your goals. If you're lucky, you'll live to be 100. And if you think about how many days there are in a year, that's 365 days a year. Multiply that together. That means you got 36,500 days in your life if you live to be 100.
We got a call from Jason.
Just saying, sorry, I got you open on the window in the green room. Okay. Hi there. I just want more of a comment. Mr. Rob,
one of your dogs years ago, almost 20 years ago, I met one of your dogs. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
You did what with one of my dogs?
I met one of your dogs, Mr. Robinson, years ago. Oh. But I found out about him on an internet forum, and then this person lived where I was going, so I said, can I drop by and meet this dog? It was from your kennel. And he was a great dog. The one thing I wanted to say about him that was neat was, this family had they live rurally. It wasn't quite a farm, but it was like an acreage or something. A big yard. So I park, and that dog lets me park and get to the front door to let the family know I'm there to visit. Is friendly, smells me, gentle. That same dog, I didn't see this, but I read about it. The guy told me, broke a window to get at somebody on the property without permission. So this dog, I didn't tell him why he was there. He just let me to the door, friendly, watched me. That same dog broke a window to get outside to get at somebody else. So that's what impressed me about that animal.
Yeah, that's probably a lucky situation, to be honest with you. You know, homeowners, the dogs will respond a lot to the lifestyle of their owner. And so that probably had a lot to do with the lifestyle of that particular owner. Personally, I think the dogs should be secured in some way or another. But even in a rural area, if a female comes in heat down the road, the dog could leave at any time. The owner of that house comes out and tells that dog to get out of here, and now you have a conflict, and that owner's going to be responsible for that. So I believe in leash laws, but I'm glad in this particular family situation, it worked out for the good.
Yeah. And all right. Go Illini. Thanks.
All right.
All right.
Thanks,
care.
Jason. Thanks for the call. Yeah. So basically, I don't know. He got lucky, huh? Because I don't know.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the dogs do follow their owner's lead, you know. So right. Maybe the owner's energy was more welcoming because they were expecting him. I don't know.
Or maybe he lives in a house where people just walk to the front door and that's okay.
The dog adjusts to that owner's lifestyle.
Yeah. 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 I would not. I mean, as someone that you know is. I've been in situations where, you know, when you get closer to the house, like I've been in a situation where there's been a big dog that was cool with me at the fence, but as I moved closer to the house, he became, I would never walk up on an unattained, unleashed dog of any size, understanding that the closer I got to the person or the people, the likelihood is that dog would change its demeanor towards me. So if I saw a dog in the middle of the street and he was just like, okay, cool. I wouldn't think that, okay, well, let me walk to the front door of this house and think it's still going to be cool. I just wouldn't do that myself.
Yeah.
You know, but I mean, hey, he made it. He lived to talk about it, so.
Yeah. And while we wait for the next one, I was saying 36,500 days, do what you want to do. Listen to other people, but don't ignore yourself.
Right. And that's important because I think one of the things that that the internet has brought us is this whole concept of, I read it on the internet, so it's true, right? So people begin to come into this, like, the first person to post anything becomes sort of the arbiter of reality, as opposed to people actually, you know, because for me personally, I started off, you know, I'm a dog lover, I'm not a dog person. So I started off my initial research on the internet. And right. You know, but I'm one to like listen a lot longer before I start talking. So I would just do a whole lot of listening. But then I would start talking to people like yourself, speaking to other people who are very experienced with different dog breeds, and I would get more nuanced understandings of things. And then I have a college degree as well, so I understand information and how to process it. I know how to reference it, get my footnotes, you know, do my back, understand understand where they got their information from, then go critique that information and try to figure out what's best. Before I start saying anything, and even then I don't say much, but I just find that there's a lot of people who just hear one thing and then that becomes a real thing and they fight to the death to believe like, this is what it is.
It's a lynch mob mentality.
Yeah.
A lynch mob mentality of a lot of times a massive number of uninformed people. And it's very scary. The terrible advice that's out there on the internet, haters exist, and unfortunately, even though haters exist, we have to be willing to decipher what is good information and what is not good information. And if you're a beginner, that's very difficult to do. You need to get advice, or I need to get advice. We all should listen to the teachers that can do or explain what we cannot do or explain. And so if you want to know if somebody's a credible source, see if they've already done what it is that you're trying to do. Right. If they've done it, then listen to them. If they have not done it, then take their opinion with a grain of salt. It may not mean anything.
Right, right. And understand that, you know, there's a value in what I would call like group problem solving, meaning that if I run into an issue and it becomes a reality to me based on the way I process information and the way I think, then I say, this is a problem that can't be solved. It doesn't mean that you as someone else who comes to that with a different perspective, that you won't easily, even with less experience, solve the problem just based on the fact that your brain processes information differently. So it's important that we not only do the research, but we got to talk to people who are actually also doing the work. So you say experiment or experience. And I think that's just as important as research, right? Like,
right.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I remember 20 years ago when I first started breeding, people didn't like some of my opinions, but the people that didn't like my opinions were people that had never bred anything and didn't have any education. They were just people that were popular on the internet. As I became, it's very important to have good teachers. This is extremely important, but be careful about selecting your teachers.
Right.
That's what I'm getting at. Get teachers that can do or explain what you cannot do or explain, and then listen to their advice and get an education and work hard, man.
Right. And my concept is always be respectful, right? You hear information that you don't agree with, respect the information. Then you got to understand, you got to do the work. You got to, you know, it goes beyond just like yelling and shouting at people in a forum. I have another call for you. It's another Jason. How's it going, how's it going, Jason?
Oh, it's all good, bro. I just wanted to join in on the call and say I agree with everything y'all saying, and I just want to shout out these little puppies I just had. Some blue.
Right, we don't want to. We don't want to shout out puppies right now, bro. We really want to stick to the subject in hand. Got a nice little litter there.
That's thanks all. I just want to show them up though, but I just appreciate you know what I'm saying, bringing me on and everything y'all doing, and I like the show. I keep watching, bro.
All right, thanks a lot, man. All right, yeah, guys, we don't want to do that. This is about education and information, not solicitation. You feel me?
Yeah.
Bars. No, I'm sorry. That's a little thing I teach my son. When you put rhyming words together, you just say bars. But yeah, Lee, I want to thank you, man. And what I will do is I'm going to I don't think we have too many more calls, so I'm going to wrap this up. It's over. We've been going for like over an hour now. I know you.
Yeah. Next time we do this, if we do it again, I'll set me up a little stand so I don't have to hold my phone.
Yeah. Okay. We got one more call. Harmon, and let's see what Harmon has to say. This is gonna be the last call, and then we'll just go ahead and move on from here.
Yeah. Bars. No, I'm sorry.
Harmon, go ahead and cut that audio off. You would the stream.
Can you hear me now?
I hear you now. Yep. Go ahead.
All right, thank you, Zeke. Thank you so much, Mr. Robinson, for doing this. I've been following your YouTube channel for about a year. Just all the information you share, it's incredible. Thank you so much for that. Honestly, don't have any sort of technical question. I really just wanted to jump on and talk with you because it's so cool that Zeke's doing this and connecting the community with all these awesome dog breeders that are across America. But one question that I would just to throw out there, I know that I was listening to your little mini podcast with the gentleman from Midgard Mastiffs. That was really cool, by the way. I hope you do more of those in the future. But
yeah, he moved to Texas, unfortunately, so he's not here anymore, but a great human being, man. Really good person.
That sucks. Well, actually, good for him. Texas is a great state. Hopefully, I get to go out there too sometime. But I know you said that you hate the question of when people ask, you know, what breeds did you use to make your specific band dog? But if you were to in the future, I know you said that you look for a dog with a specific trait that you want to incorporate. You know, you don't necessarily look for the breed. But have you ever thought about a different breed that you would want to start mixing in with your band dog in the future? I'm just curious.
Well, good question. It's not that I don't like the question. It's because the question comes with a bit of prejudice on breed generalities. And one of the things that we should always look at when it comes to dealing with individuals is let's not forget the individual that we're dealing with, because breed generalities don't always fit the individual. We have to look at this particular individual that we are using. Just because it's a pit bull doesn't mean it's going to be a game bred dog. You know, 90% of pit bulls are not game bred dogs. So, but with to address your question, the breeds that I think would be worth looking into, to me today, the Tosa Inu is still something to look into. The Presa might be something worth looking into. The Borbal might be something that's worth looking into. These breeds, if you get a good individual from a working program and they're consistent and you find the best of the best from that program, some of the work may already be done for you. But nothing, in my opinion, can replace a high-quality game-bred American Pit Bull Terrier. Those dogs, in my opinion, are the peak, the pinnacle on a pound-for-pound basis.
Okay. All right. Awesome. Very well, nice. Thanks again so much, sir. Hopefully I get to have one of your dogs in the future.
Yes, sir. I appreciate the inquiry.
All right. Thanks a lot, Harmon. Great question, bro. Great question. Yeah, you know, I definitely agree with you on the concept of the Presa. I'm almost surprised that you haven't already looked into the Presa.
We worked a bunch of Presas. The problem that I've encountered with the Presa, I do believe that good individuals in the Presa community exist. Okay, there are some good ones out there, but every one we've worked did not balance well. We had some that had prey, we had some that had defense, we had some that had power. I've never seen a Presa that had endurance. So, with endurance and heat tolerance being important, and also prey and prey and defense also being able to balance that, that being important. The consistency, in my opinion, I have not seen it in the pressing community. Mm. The, and I hate to say what I'm about to say, but I'm going to say it. And it, to me, the pressa community needs to really unite and save that breed, because right now it's headed the wrong direction. Right. It's getting bigger, sloppier. It's like some of these people are just trying to get the biggest presses out there. They're starting to get fatter and fatter. Why did these people get interested in these dogs? You know, it cracks me up that society as a whole looks at certain breeds that have gladiators in their ancestry as if they're taboo, but then we make mascots for universities named after the bulldog or the dragon. These very formidable animals, these dogs display determination, and determination is a good trait to have if it's directed correctly. And strength is a good trait to have if it's used correctly. But why are we prioritizing weight when that weight is coming from body fat? That's not a priority. So why are we prioritizing size when it's coming from a strength of handicap? So when handicap and body fat become prioritized, then the breeds are going the wrong direction. They need to stay healthy, athletic, strong.
No, I totally agree with you. And that's what I was going to say, because I filmed a few yards. And I would, when you,
there's some good ones out there. I would, if I was starting over, I would tour again, just like I did 20 years ago. I would go around and tour and look at the presser communities and see if I could find me a presser that's what that breed is capable of, if that's the breed that I wanted to get into. One of the things that's cool about the Bandog is I'm not trapped in that breed specific barrier. You know, I can be open minded and open my stud book and breed to the best dog, and I don't have to worry about it.
Right, but I will say that there's a yard up in Northern California, and literally, you know, when you talk about size and weight, like his presses, his males were like 95 to like maybe they were. When I remember thinking like, yo, his dogs are small, because I was thinking presses are 125.
Shout out his name. You don't just shout out the name of the program. I'm not offended by it.
No. I'm trying to remember it. Actually, I have a video. It's my biggest presser video. I want to say I don't remember. It's mucho something. It's not mucho grande. I'll put a link to it. I don't remember exactly the name. It's a brother. He's up in Northern California. If you watch my videos, you know the presser. You'll know the presser video. Cool. Yeah. No. So his dogs are like literally, because I did one before where the dogs were like 130 pounds presses, but his were smaller. And I remember coming to his yard thinking like, yo, these are kind of small. But to me, they were way more athletic. They were doing hog work, and they had an edge to them that I was very much aware of as I was in their facility, right? Because these dogs were kind of serious dogs. That's what, when I think of a dog, it's possible that a dog might bite me, I say he's serious, right? So I don't play with him, and I try to be as mindful of my proximity to anything that he may claim as that he's protecting. So he had a lot of dogs.
Yeah.
I don't know. Like I said, I don't have much more experience than just that day and a half I spent with him, but his dogs were, roughly 80 to maybe his biggest dog might've been 105 pounds at the biggest.
Am I freezing up on you bad as I walk away?
A little bit, but I was talking, so I wasn't really paying attention to you. I think we got one more call.
Say before we hang up, if you want.
No, give me, we got one more call. No, don't hang up.
Go ahead.
Yeah, we'll take Emerson, and then we're going to be done. Thanks, Emerson, for being patient. Go ahead, talk to me, bro.
Yeah. I just wanted to know, what is the reason that you crop your dog's tail, or dock your dog's tail?
Yeah, good question. All right. A lot of people actually think that a dog with a cropped tail is going to lose its balance. Our dogs are so athletic, it's ridiculous. There's no problem there. In fact, people that think that a lot of times come from the game dog world. Go look up Golden King's champion silver. The dog is the only dog ever in history that has defeated 3 grand champions. And he had a bobtail. Now, does the bobtail make the dog better? Absolutely not. What it does, though, is it prevents injury when a dog lives in close quarters. So if you're living in the woods and you have a long tail, you're not likely to run into things that are going to injure your tail. But when you're living in a home environment and you're dealing with doors or people that grab, the tail becomes something that you have to be mindful of to not trap it in a door, or to if a criminal is working with another person, like two people come in, one person can grab the tail and swing the dog. So it helps eliminate some of the possible liability to the dog. It eliminates a dog doesn't have to worry about it. However, I don't dock it short. I like to still see that dog's body language. I want to know what he's thinking. So I do a mid-length dock that, to me, the vast majority of the injuries or handicaps of the tail come on the outer half. So we do a mid-length dock. We used to do a quarter dock, then we went to a third. Now I just do a 50% dock. And when some of our dogs, when you look at them as adults, it looks like their tail's not full length. Well, I noticed that when you dock a tail, it kind of like stunts the tail's growth a little bit. So when we cut it 50% at like 4 weeks, when that dog is an adult, it'll actually be about a third length tail. And I can still see that dog's body language. He can still protect his reproductive organs. He can still protect his anus, but it's not going to get trapped in the door. And it's not going to be an easy handle for a criminal to grab and swing the dog when there's two people working together. So I don't see it being a hindrance at all. Now, for a high-speed courser, maybe like a greyhound or a cheetah that's using that as a counterbalance, then maybe. But for a close-quarters combat type of dog, I think more of the bobcat and the lynx. The bobcat and the lynx are close-quarter combat dogs. They're ambush predators. And these ambush predators really just don't need that tail as a counterbalance.
Perfect. Yeah, I know I have a Rottweiler. He kept his tail. And I can't tell you, every day I walk out the backyard, he follows me. And I'm always mindful not to close his tail in the door. It's just something that I always think about.
Well, 20 years ago, I'll tell you this. I saw a dog get ran over. And when it ran over, the car actually tore all the skin off the tail from a third of the way down. It came off like a sock. It was crazy that we were just holding the skin. The tail was still in the dog. It had the meat and the bone, but no skin.
Right.
The dog was screaming. The dog was screaming and screaming and screaming in a lot of pain. Because, I mean, if you've ever peeled the skin off of a sunburnt, I don't know, y'all probably don't get sunburnt, but if you ever peel the skin off of an injury, you know it stings, right?
Right.
So the dog was not comfortable. And unfortunately, this happened on a Sunday morning. So the vets were closed.
Right.
So what are you going to do? Well, the person that owned the dog took the dog over to a stump and did a hatchet on the tail and just cut the tail off right where the skin was. And amazingly, 5 seconds after he did it, the dog was running around acting like nothing happened.
Mm.
It was so amazing that all the pain that the dog was experiencing was from that tail injury. And when he just cut it off and severed it, it didn't bother the dog anymore. Mm. Like 5 seconds later, the dog was back to normal. Wow. So it was amazing. But right, I would never dock a dog that's an adult. I would not do that.
Okay? Right,
if you're
going
to dock a dog, dock the dog's tail when it's a puppy.
Right. All right, Emerson, thanks for the great question, man. And we got a gruesome story out of it, so you win the question of the day. All right, thanks,
man. Yeah, I wasn't trying to gross you out, but...
No, that's cool, it's cool.
It's a good question.
It happens, man, it happens. That's the other thing about owning a dog. Scary things do happen. It's just part of life. But all right, Mr. Robinson, thank you so much.
Yeah.
I'm going to look at some more...
What I was going to say earlier is, before we get off, before we hang up, do you want me to try to do a walk through the kennel, or would it be...
Let's give it a try. I know some people were asking, and we know we tried to do a walkthrough earlier, and let's try it again. Let's go ahead and give it a try.
Yeah, if it breaks up too much, my apologies.
No problem.
I don't think cellular data is going to be able to survive it.
That's all good.
I need to get a Wi-Fi extender. And this is one of the problems with live videos. You can't do a pre-recording in.
Right.
And,
Well, actually, next time, if you want, you can record and then just send me the video that I could just play it back for them.
All right, that'll work.
Yeah.
So here's our kennel. If this will turn around.
There you go.
This is Scratch. buddy. I don't know if y'all can see him.
Yeah, we're getting we're getting freeze frames right now.
Yeah, I was afraid that might happen for two reasons. One, too far from the house for Wi-Fi. Plus, the kennel's got a ton of metal in it.
Right.
No metal and does not work well. So we may just, I'll send you a pre-recorded video.
Send me a video. We can do this again. I mean, I think you said there's a lot of things that we didn't touch on that we can touch on. We're at about an hour and, an hour and 30 minutes right now. So that's quite a long video. But yeah, so we'll work something out. I mean, like I said, really what I want to talk to you about is the whole, I wanted to talk about Bandogs, but I want to also talk about, you know, creating your own dogs. You know, I'm sure there's other people who help you with what you're doing, but you don't have the services of, you know, tons of other breeders working on the same project as you're working on. You're a very specific person breeding a very specific dog. And you know, I'm sure there's a lot of science and math that goes into what you do and how you do it. And I'm sure that they would love to hear about that as well.
Well, we'll be glad to work with it. I'll tell you something, just a thought. Well, we'll do it when my family's gone, when we have the more scientific questions and I can do it inside.
Right.
And that way we won't have to deal with me telling a 5-year-old girl, be quiet or whatever, because, you know, 5-year-olds can only be quiet for so long.
I understand. Yeah, I'm in a garage. I'm out behind my house, and halfway through the interview, my son came out, started playing basketball. I had to have my wife put him back in the house. So I'm sure he wants to get outside and play basketball.
And if you have some other questions that you want me to do in the kennels, you can just send me a list of questions, and I can address those in a video.
Okay.
And then I'll send you the video, and you can upload it to your channel.
All right. Perfect. Perfect. Well, thanks a lot for your time. I know and I still would love to come out because I would love to see you guys do. I would love to actually film some hog dogs doing some catch work. That's possible.
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
You tell me what season that happens, or is that a year-round thing in Mississippi, or is that?
It's a year-round thing, except we have to avoid the hunting seasons for deer and turkey,
right.
Because you can't. You can use a weapon that's legal in the. You can hunt hogs year-round, but
right.
You can only use the weapon that's allowed to be used. So you can legally hunt hogs during deer season or turkey season, but you're going to offend the turkey hunters and the deer hunters because you're going to be running across them with dogs. And that's a good way to get dogs shot or
right.
to cause problems with your community. So basically speaking, that's one of the reasons why hog hunters use knives and they hunt when these other seasons are closed. That way they don't offend any hunters, and they're just using a knife, which is legal.
All right, well, we'll talk about that, and we'll talk about maybe doing another live very soon, whenever you have time, but you know, sooner than late, I'm sure, because I'm excited about getting some more information out of you for the folks watching the videos.
Well, I appreciate the interest. Thank you for your support, and we'd be glad to help you out.
All right, thanks a lot, guys. And if you want to check out Mr. Robinson's channel, it's American Sentinel Canine. It's on YouTube. You have a Facebook and an Instagram as well, right?
I do have a Facebook and an Instagram, but I almost never use Instagram, and I very seldom use Facebook. The more time goes on, I'm still involved in Facebook, but not as much as I used to. I am a full-time teacher. I also have a 9 acres that I keep up, and I've got a family, and I've got 27 dogs. So social media is not my biggest strength right now. The best way to get a hold of me is through email and or Facebook. Facebook and email is the two best ways. Or call. You know, feel free to call.
Okay, perfect. And you have a website as well, AmericanSentinelCanine.com. Okay.
Yep, or just AmericanBandDog.com. It's even easier, AmericanBandDog.com.
Okay, perfect. Well, thanks a lot, man. I appreciate you, and I will be talking to you shortly.
You take care. God
bless. Take it easy now. All right, bye-bye. All right, guys, there you have it. Another, what I think, great video. What I love about these videos, I think I've mentioned this before, is that, you know, a lot of times I talk to people on the phone before I interview them or before I go to film their yards and stuff, and a lot of these conversations inform me and what I understand about dogs. Those conversations go on for hours sometimes. Like this conversation today, it was an hour and a half. And I'm thinking this is great for you guys to see. I think this live setup right here is really working out well for me. I'm going to do more of these. I'm going to reach out to more people to get you guys more information. So, you know, and you guys can also participate in the conversation. We do have the ability to have you guys call in and ask questions. All right, guys, thanks a lot to everyone. Thanks to Donald DJ for moderating the chat session. Thanks to everyone who gave a super chat. Thanks for everyone who left a comment. Thanks for everyone that gave this video a thumbs up. I appreciate you guys. I will talk to you guys very shortly. Working on some things right now, and I will be doing some lives in the coming week. All right, guys, talk to you later. Peace.